Okay, so good morning students. I welcome you back to this lecture series on rhetoric on prosody. This is the second lecture in the series of rhetoric and prosody. In the last video, I explained five figures of speech. I gave you the definition of what a particular figure of speech is. And we discussed certain figures of speech, to rewind a bit. Now, coming back to today's task, we will again be completing five figures of speech today. So the first figure of speech that we will be dealing today with is pun, P-U-N, pun. So the heading will be pun. Let me first explain what pun is all about. What is pun actually? Now, whenever or if you have ever gone through Julius Caesar, written by William Shakespeare, you will find that in Act 1, Scene 1 of Julius Caesar, when Roman citizens are actually roaming on the streets of Rome, obviously since they are Roman citizens, so they will roam around the city-states. So when they were roaming around the streets, two of the ministers of the king come to them and ask one of them the question that particular minister asks is, what is your profession? What is your profession? This is a question that has been asked by the minister to a particular man who is dressed in new clothes and roaming around the streets on a weekday. So that is the reason why the minister asks him, it is a working day today and you have no work, you are roaming around the street. It's as if you are going for a picnic on a working day. What are you doing here? What is your profession, by the way? So the minister asks, what is your profession? The reply of that particular person is, sir, I mend souls. I mend souls. Okay, so when I speak this particular sentence, I mend souls, what is the meaning of this particular sentence? There are two meanings of this particular sentence. The first meaning is, I mend souls. The first meaning is, I am a cobbler. Souls, I mend souls. So what does a cobbler do? The cobbler mends souls. And the spelling of that soul is S-O-L-E. So the reply of that particular man is, I am a mender of souls. What he tries to mean is, I am a cobbler. But the minister who has asked the question, he gathers a complete different meaning altogether. He thinks that this particular man is being very arrogant, because he is trying to say that he will mend my soul. S-O-U-L, Atma. But that man was very clear when he said that I am a mender of souls. That means he is trying to mean that he is a cobbler. But it has been misunderstood by the minister. He thinks that the cobbler is actually trying to say that he will mend his soul. He will correct him morally. So there is a pun on the word soul, because while speaking in a conversation, while we are speaking, definitely I will not be telling you the spelling of soul. So while watching a particular play, definitely the actor will not come in front of the audience or the front stage and he will not declare that the spelling of soul is S-O-L-E. I am not talking of S-O-U-L. That is not the case. The audience has to guess. It is left up to the audience to understand that the soul that he is trying to communicate, the meaning of the soul that the cobbler is trying to communicate is different from the meaning of the soul that this minister has actually guessed. And what is the effect of this particular pun? It creates humor. So pun is usually used for humor so that the audience have a small laugh at it. Okay, so that is the function of a pun. In fact, if you remember in 12th night, act 1 scene 1, once again, if you remember, there was this particular word used by Duke Orsino, the word called heart. The word called heart. Now, heart has two meanings. The first meaning is a deer, D-E-E-R, H-A-R-T. The pronunciation is the same, H-A-R-T, heart. Heart means a deer. And H-E-A-R-T is also pronounced heart. But that heart is this one, the emotion, one that is related to the emotion. So there is a pun on the word heart. Okay, so these are examples of pun. So what we will do is, as our custom is, now I will give you a definition of pun and then two examples related to pun. I suppose these examples are enough to clear your idea of what pun is all about. So first we will write down the definition of a pun. Okay, so what is a pun? Write it down. The pun is based upon, the pun is based upon the foundation, the pun is based upon the foundation of verbal ambiguity. The pun is based upon the foundation of verbal ambiguity, of verbal, V-E-R-B-A-L, verbal ambiguity, A-M-B-I-G-U-I-T-Y. Now, I suppose you know what's the meaning of ambiguity. Dual sense. There are more than one meaning of a particular word. Ambiguity, ambiguous. The witches in Macbeth always spoke in a kind of an ambiguous tone. They always had a kind of a dual meaning inherent in their speeches. Ambiguity, ambiguous. Okay. So the pun is based upon the foundations of verbal ambiguity. Full stop. It consists in the use of the same sound. It consists in the use of the same sound to convey different meanings. Use of the same sound to convey different meanings. And the effect is comical. C-O-M-I-C-A-L. And the effect is comical. Okay, so the first example of pun is, as I told you earlier, I am a mender of soul. I am a mender of soul. When you are writing it down, definitely it has to be S-O-L-E. I am a mender of souls. Give a hyphen and mention the name of the play. It's from Julius Caesar, written by Shakespeare. Okay, this is the first example. Okay, the second example. When a woman loses her husband, now remember the spelling of loses is L-O-S-E-S. When a woman loses her husband, comma, she pines for a second. She pines, P-I-N-E-S. She pines, P-I-N-E-S. She pines for a second. S-E-C-O-N-D. Now, what is the meaning of this particular sentence? That when a woman loses her first husband, she desires for the second. This is one of the meanings that actually come out of it. Okay, but there is another meaning to this particular thing. When a woman loses her husband, she pines for a second means she thinks about her first husband for a second. She moans about her husband for a second. It does not imply that she desires for a second husband altogether. So when a woman loses a husband, she pines for a second. She pines for a second means she complains, she moans for a second, she thinks of her first husband and his death and what is to be done now. She pines for a second. Okay. So moving on to the other example. Okay, I think pun is almost clear to you with those two examples that I provided to you. Now we move on to the second figure of speech that we will be dealing today. Okay, so the second figure of speech that we will be dealing today with is alliteration. This is also one of the easiest of figures of speech. So the spelling of alliteration is A-L-L-I-T-E-R-A-T-I-O-N. So the second figure of speech for today is alliteration. Now, what do you mean by an alliteration? Suppose अगर बांग्ला में कहें उसको जो दी बांग्ला बोली इट्स लाइक पाखी पाका पेपे खाए पाखी पाका पेपे खाए द साउंड प इज रिपीटेड मोर देन वंस इन दिस पर्टिकुलर सेंटेंस पाखी प पाका प पेपे प खाए ओके सो द साउंड प इज रिपीटेड मोर देन वंस इन अ पर्टिकुलर सेंटेंस. Similarly, a Hindi example of alliteration will be Chandu ke chacha ne Chandu ki chachi ko Chandni chowk mein Chandni raat mein Chandi ki chammach se chatni chatai. So see to it, cha, the sound cha. I am talking about the sound cha, the sound pa, the sound cha has been repeated more than once in this particular sentence. So that becomes an example of alliteration. Suppose if I give you an example, the lake water lapping on the shore. The lake water lapping on the shore. The lake law water lapping la. La or la. Dekho, ek se zyada sound jahan par honge, usko hum log alliteration kahenge. Ek se zyada similar sound. Lake water la, lapping la. So the lake water lapping on the shore. This is what alliteration is all about. Suppose first let me give you the definition of what alliteration is all about. So write down the definition of alliteration. Lekho, alliteration consists in repetition. Alliteration consists in repetition. R-E-P-E-T-I-T-I-O-N. In repetition, alliteration consists in repetition of the same letter. Repetition of the same letter in the case of Pakhi, Paka, Pepe, Pa. Repetition of the same letter, comma, syllable, S-Y-L-L-A-B-L-E, syllable. Now, what is a syllable? We will definitely discuss this when we go to the prosody section, when we discuss about word stress. There are certain words which are stressed. There are certain words which are not stressed. Okay. In day-to-day speech, jab bhi hum log conversation karte hain, to there are certain words jis pe zor jyada padta hai. So that is stressed. Jaro pure zor pade na, that is unstressed. So we will be dealing with syllable when we go to the prosody section. We are dealing with the rhetoric section. So we will stick to this particular thing. Okay. So alliteration consists in the repetition of the same letter, syllable or sound, S-O-U-N-D, sound, at the beginning at the beginning, BEGINNING, at the beginning of successive, at the beginning of successive, SUCCESSIVE, at the beginning of successive words, at the beginning of successive words, WORDS, at the beginning of successive words. Full stop. This is the definition of alliteration. Now the point is very clear. The sound has to be repeated more than once in a sentence. Then only it becomes an example of alliteration. Now we come to the example part. Write down the first example on alliteration. The fair breeze blew. The fair, F-A-I-R. The fair breeze, B-R-E-E-Z-E. The fair breeze blew, B-L-E-W, comma. The white foam flew. The white foam, F-O-A-M. The white foam flew, F-L-E-W, comma. Next line. I haven't yet completed the sentence. Okay, comma, next line. The furrow followed free. The furrow, F-U-R-R-O-W. The furrow followed, F-O-L-L-O-W-E-D. The furrow followed free, F-R-E-E. The furrow followed free. Okay, full stop. So this is a complete sentence. Now what you need to find here is, this line is an example of alliteration. And why do I say so? Because the sound F is repeated more than once in this particular sentence. And you have to, there is one common trivia to it. These particular lines belong to a poem written by Coleridge. Okay. So what I'm trying to say here is that a particular sound fur, the sound fur, fla, fur, fear, the sound fur is repeated more than once in this particular sentence. And since I'm talking of sounds, that is the reason why I'm not calling it F, I'm calling it fur. Okay, the sound is fur, for, jeta camera bole, it's not F here. The sound is repeated more than once in a sentence, so it becomes an example of alliteration. So, the second example of alliteration, if I can give you, the lake water lapping on the shore, as I told you earlier. The lake water lapping on the shore, S-H-O-R-E. The lake water lapping on the shore, S-H-O-R-E. The lake water lapping on the shore, S-H-O-R-E. So which sound is repeated here more than once? It's the L sound, not L. L sound is repeated more than once in this particular sentence, so it becomes an example of alliteration. Okay, so this is what alliteration is all about. So now we move on to our third figure of speech. Okay, so our third figure of speech for today is chiasmus. And the spelling is C-H-I-A-S-M-U-S. So the third figure of speech that we will be dealing with today is chiasmus. Okay, so that is the spelling of chiasmus. Now, what is chiasmus? To quote a very famous line from John Keats, beauty is truth, comma, truth is beauty, or truth beauty. Beauty is truth, comma, truth beauty. To give you another example from Macbeth itself, fear is foul and foul is fear. So in these particular two sentences, what similarity do you find in both these sentences? I think the main similarity that you find in these two sentences is beauty is truth, comma, truth beauty. You find a kind of a displacement of the subject object places. So in the case of first example, beauty is truth, beauty is in the subject position and truth is in the object position. And after the comma, beauty is truth, comma, truth, beauty. See, the place changes. The object becomes the subject and the subject becomes the object. Similarly, if you look at fear is foul and foul is fear, you find the same criteria working in this particular case also. This order of replacement is actually called chiasmus. This is called chiasmus. In fact, one of the very famous examples of chiasmus is from a very old movie. As I remember, that was before my birth itself. The name of the movie was Amar Akbar Antony. And the song where this particular chiasmus is present is Anhoni ko honi kar de, Anhoni ko honi kar de, Honi ko anhoni, Anhoni ko honi kar de, Honi ko anhoni. So you find a reversal of places. Anhoni becomes object, anhoni becomes the subject, kind of a thing. So this is also chiasmus. Then a modern reference to a particular chiasmus is Ram chahe lila chahe, lila chahe Ram. It might sound a kind of a rebellion kind of a thing, talking about Bollywood movies here, but I think it's a better thing to do when you're dealing with rhetoric, so that it sticks to your brain, the kind of thing that I'm trying to tell, convey you. So chiasmus is actually rearranging of certain subject object phrases or words. So Ram chahe lila chahe, lila chahe Ram. See, you find that beauty is truth, truth beauty. Fear is foul, foul is fear. Ram chahe lila chahe, lila chahe Ram. So these are all examples of chiasmus. So first, let us write down the definition of chiasmus. It's again one of the simplest of figures of speech. The figures of speech which are really very difficult to handle are the ones which are very exciting, and I will come to them quite at the very last of this particular session. When I am about to complete figures of speech, I will do it at the last. Okay, so the definition of chiasmus is, chiasmus consists in an inversion. Chiasmus consists in an inversion of the order of words. Chiasmus consists in an inversion of the order of words or phrases, order of words or phrases, phrases. Now, when I use the word phrases, phrases, see, we are writing it down as phrases, but the sound is not of paw or haw. The sound is of f, phrases, f. The word starts with the sound f, phrases, okay? So the sound is a different thing altogether, and alphabets are a different thing. These are all what might be called phonemes. Okay, we will come back to that. You will also learn about it. So coming back to the definition of chiasmus. Chiasmus consists in an inversion of the order of words or phrases, phrases, when repeated, or subsequently referred to in the same sentence, or subsequently referred to in the same sentence. So that becomes an example of chiasmus. Okay, so this is the definition of chiasmus that we have. Now, if we talk of examples, I gave you the first example, beauty is truth, comma, truth, beauty. I think you have read this particular line in Ode on a Grecian Urn by John Keats in semester 4. Okay, so beauty is truth, comma, truth, beauty. This is the first example. And the second example, as I told you, fear is foul and foul is fear. Fear is foul and foul is fear. F-A-I-R. Foul is fear. So I suppose there won't be any problem with chiasmus as such. And to remind you one other thing, while I am giving you this particular definition of chiasmus, in the background to this particular lecture, there are sounds of dogs barking at each other. This sound is also an example of onomatopoeia. My voice is also an example of onomatopoeia. The sound of the fan is also an example of onomatopoeia. So while I am delivering a lecture to you, there are three cases of onomatopoeia that are actually occurring simultaneously while I am actually taking this particular class. Okay, so that becomes an example of onomatopoeia. Okay, so this is what chiasmus is all about. Okay, now we move on to the next figure of speech. Okay, so now we'll be dealing with a new figure of speech called hyperbaton. Okay, so let us start with an example from hyperbaton itself. Suppose if I give you an example, just, J-U-S-T, just are the ways of God. Just, J-U-S-T, are the ways of God. God capitalized, G. Just are the ways of God. Full stop. Now, don't you think that there is a kind of a grammatical incorrectness in this particular sentence? It is grammatically incorrect. The sentence is grammatically incorrect because in English sentences, the construction is first comes the subject, then the verb, and then the object. This is the construction of an English sentence: subject, verb, object. But the sentence that I have given you just now as an example of hyperbaton, go through that sentence. Just are the ways of God. This is an incorrect construction. So what will be the correct construction? The correct construction will be, the ways of God are just. This is the correct construction. Now let me tell you, this particular line has been taken from John Milton. Just are the ways of God. This line is taken from John Milton, and we know who John Milton is. He is the writer of an epic, Paradise Lost. So, what do you think? Was John Milton not aware of the grammatical order of English conversation or English speech or English grammar? Or John Milton is deliberately inverting the grammatical structure for the sake of poetic emphasis? The point is, Milton is aware of the fact that he is breaking the law or rule of grammar, of English grammar. But he does this deliberately. This is a deliberate kind of an attempt on the part of John Milton. And why does he do that? For poetic emphasis. For poetic emphasis, for rhythm, for rhyme. That is the reason why. And as we know, each and every author or a writer or a creative artist has a kind of a poetic license. But having a poetic license does not imply that that particular writer or a creative artist is not aware of the grammar of English. He or she is definitely well aware of the grammar. But he or she is doing this only for the sake of emphasis or for rhythm or rhyme. Okay, so just are the ways of God to men. Now we will begin again with the definition of hyperbaton, H-Y-P-E-R-B-A-T-O-N. So write down the definition. Hyperbaton is a figure, F-I-G-U-R-E, in which there is an inversion. In which there is an inversion, I-N-V-E-R-S-I-O-N. There is an inversion of the regular, grammatical order of words. Regular grammatical order of words, W-O-R-D-S. Regular grammatical order of words. In a sentence, to secure S-E-C-U-R-E, to secure emphasis, E-M-P-H-A-S-I-S, to secure emphasis, E-M-P-H-A-S-I-S. So as I told you earlier, that for the sake of emphasis, this particular grammatical order is inverted or reversed. And one of the basic examples, as I gave you just now, you can write down that particular example. Just are the ways of God. Just are the ways of God. Just are the ways of God. To give you another example of hyperbaton, much have I seen and known. Much have I seen and known. K-N-O-W-N. Much have I seen and known. So this is the second example of hyperbaton. So this is what hyperbaton. Achha, hyperbaton is also known as inversion. I-N-V-E-R-S-I-O-N. Hyperbaton is also known as inversion. I-N-V-E-R-S-I-O-N. Okay. So now we move on to the next figure of speech and the last one for today. The figure of speech is palilogia. Palilogia. The spelling is P-A-L-I-L-O-G-I-A. Palilogia. P-A-L-I-L-O-G-I-A. Palilogia. Now, again, we will start with an example so that the concept becomes very clear. Write down the example before writing down the definition that we will be discussing later. So the example is happy bows. Again, this example is from Ode on a Grecian Urn, if you remember, from John Keats. Happy comma happy bows, happy bows, b-o-u-g-h-s, happy comma happy bows, exclamation mark, that cannot shed, s-h-e-d, happy bows, that cannot shed, s-h-e-d. This is the sentence, full stop. Now this sentence is actually an example of palilogia, because the word happy has been used more than once. Happy. Okay, so this is what palilogia is all about. If I give you another example, write down the other example also. O earth, comma, again O earth, comma, O earth. O earth is written thrice. O earth, comma, O earth, comma, O earth, comma. Hear the voice of the dead. Hear, H-E-A-R. Hear the voice of the dead, D-E-A-D. O earth, comma, O earth, comma, O earth. Hear the voice of the dead. So this is again an example of palilogia, because O earth has been repeated more than once in this particular sentence. To give you another example of palilogia, this is another variety of palilogia. So write down the sentence. So various, so beautiful, so new. So various, so beautiful, so new. So various, comma, so beautiful, comma, and so new. Now, this is also an example of palilogia. See, so has been repeated more than once in this particular sentence. So this is also an example of palilogia, because so has been reiterated or repeated more than once. Okay. Now we come to the definition of palilogia. It's as simple. Write it down. In this figure, there is the simple reiteration, R-E-I-T-E-R-A-T-I-O-N. In this figure, there is the simple reiteration of the same word, word or words, W-R-D-S, in a line or sentence. in a line or sentence. So this is again an example of pally. This is actually the definition of palylogia. The examples were discussed earlier. Now, so we completed 5 figures of speech today. We completed 5 yesterday. So the tally comes to 10. You need to practice these figures of speech so that you become quite competent in identifying. Remember, identification is the key to the description and as well as the critical comment regarding these figures of speech. Because if you are unable to identify a figure of speech, then your description, your definitions, your explanation does not make sense. So identification is the key to figures of speech. What you can do is you need to practice figures of speech. You can do that at home. I will give you certain home assignments too after we complete figures of speech. We have just completed 10. I think we have to complete around 22. There are hundreds of figures of speech, but we will complete the major portions, major ones that amount to 22. So we will be doing this slowly but steadily as we progress. And after this, we will be going to prosody, because for prosody we need board work. So I need to have a board ready so that I can show you how prosody or scansion is actually done. You must be having a preliminary idea of what scansion is all about or prosody is all about, but we will discuss about that in detail too. So while you have time and during this corona COVID kind of a thing, pandemic, you can utilize your time reading certain books. You can go through, if you haven't seen a movie by Mrinal Sen, this movie which I'm talking about was released in 1971, most probably directed by Mrinal Sen, even before most of us were born. Actually, you people were not born. This movie received a national award that year. The name of the movie was Akale Shondhane, In Search of a Kind of a Pandemic. Akale Shondhane, In Search of a Pandemic kind of a situation, in search of kind of those circumstances where you don't have food to eat or anything of that sort. So the name of the movie is Akale Shondhane by Mrinal Sen. Go through that particular movie, and after you watch that particular movie, make it a kind of a goal to watch it on YouTube. The movie is available on YouTube, and for non-Bengali viewers, you must also go through this movie, because there are subtitles on YouTube too, so there won't be any problem for you to understand what is going on. Because that particular movie, I am referring to you this movie because you will find a particular technique has been used in this particular movie. The technique is called within a movie. Movie within a movie. It is actually a movie about making a movie. So Akale Shondhane is about making a movie on Akal. Kabhi Akal padha tha. उस पे एक मूवी बनानी है. तो देर आर ग्रुप ऑफ एक्टर्स हु कम टू अ पर्टिकुलर विलेज एंड व्हाट हैपेंस टू देम. ठीक है, दे आर ट्राइंग टू मेक अ मूवी ऑन अकाल इन दैट पर्टिकुलर विलेज. सो देर इज दिस टेक्निक ऑफ मूवी विद इन अ मूवी इन दिस पर्टिकुलर मूवी कॉल्ड अकाले शोंधने बाय मृणाल सेन. इट्स अ मास्टरपीस, यू मस्ट वॉच इट. एंड एज फॉर नॉवल रीडिंग, इफ यू वॉन्ट टू रीड सर्टन नॉवल्स, my suggestion for this week will be you can go through My Name is Red by Orhan Pamuk. My Name is Red, R-E-D, by Orhan Pamuk. Jara Hindi, jara write, jara readers, tum log pad sakte ho Pal Gomra ka Scooter. Agar ho sake to Pal Gomra ka Scooter bol ke ek kahani hai, written by Uday Prakash. तो आप पाल गोमरा का स्कूटर पढ़ सकते हैं. प्लस उदय प्रकाश की और एक कहानी है तिरीच. तिरीच इज अवेलेबल ऑन गूगल, तो यू कैन फाइंड द पीडीएफ ऑफ तिरीच ऑन गूगल. बट पाल गोमरा का स्कूटर इज़ नॉट अवेलेबल ऑन पीडीएफ, ऑन नेट इट्स नॉट अवेलेबल. तिरीच पढ़ सकते हो तुम लोग, तिरीच, रिटन बाय उदय प्रकाश. So go through this particular books and movie. Enjoy your weekend. Have a healthy weekend. With this signing off, we will be dealing with the third section of figures of speech quite soon. We will meet again after this weekend. So with this, have a good day.